I met Berry Gordy through my brother, Edward. I wanted to sing at the time.
I met Berry Gordy while I was in the Romeos. At the time that we had got the bad news from Atlantic, we sort of like went around looking for another label. So that's when I met Berry Gordy.
He took me down and introduced me to Berry. And so Berry said, well, you know, to have me come on by the house. And
anyway, Berry was living with his sister, and he had a little studio in the basement of Lucy's house. And boy, this brings us a lot of memories.
Edward was singing demos for Berry, for Jackie Wilson. Berry Gordy was writing songs for Jackie Wilson.
And we went to his place, and this guy was in this basement and said what he could do for us. And I said, he's got to be kidding.
I got a contract to sing like with the Satin Tones. And soon, I mean, after then, a little later on, I got a writer and producer's contract.
But I said, yeah, okay, thanks, man, for your time. Black guy in the basement of some house, you know, please. You know what I mean? After all, we had been on Atlantic, you know what I mean? But it's
the writer's contract came about and the producer's contract came about because I did come up with a hit record called Please Mr. Postman. It went to number one on three different artists. First time in history that ever happened. On the Beatles, the Carpenters, and the Marvelettes. I knew his wife, Ann Dozier.
And I think she's actually the one that set up that particular second meeting with Berry.
But anyway, she wanted me to meet him. So I said, okay, fine. So he came over to the studio one day to really actually to get with Berry.
And I came over and like I said, we talked and...
But he came over anyway and I met him and he was down in the studio playing a song. I said, man, I like that song. What is that you doing? He said, a little something I got here. So I said, that sounds good.
And I was singing, darling, forever, forever, da 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 da. And then Brian Kidd walked up and heard, oh, hey, man, what's that about? You know, man, I like that. And we started the collaboration from that moment.
We could put out more songs if we form as a team. You guys write the melodies, come up with some ideas and stuff, and I write the lyrics.
That's when I went to Brian. I said, you and Lamont are very, very good. I said, you're very, very fast. I said, but the problem is you come up with tracks and melodies faster than you're able to write them.
And so when the suggestion came up that he could do some of the lyrics and that type of thing, and we could get more done, it sounded great to me.
When they got together, Lamont decided that his record wasn't really a chart buster, and they had a lot of ideas, and they had a lot of things in common. So they started writing, and I'm proud to say that when they finally penned their first composition, they thought of me.
But we was upstairs, and Lamont came and played, and it sounded good. Don't get these men, because I think he even came up with the idea.
It was a song that I had thought up and wanted to give to Loretta Lynn.
He played it, and we, you know, we do little checkpoints and say, what, well, we need a turnaround here or a musical break there, and then we map it out, you know what I mean, and then we'll call a session.
There were no sheets written. It was all top of the head sessions. There were no session notes. There were no chord changes written. It was an idea that Eddie and Lamont and Brian got together, and after they played it a couple of times, they let the musicians hear.
Becomes kind of sought after. After you want to say, people want to, yeah, come to ask us to write songs for them. You know?
Girl, it's dark.
guy didn't want to do the song. He thought that Lawrence should sing it, you know, because he didn't think he had the chops. He had no confidence in himself for doing the, to be out front like that. He said, no. So Eddie insisted upon it. He said, no, man, you got to sing this song.
Well, I can't really feel it. He said, why don't you let Lawrence sing it? I said, no. I want you to sing it. I said, listen, you did not learn the song. I said, do me a favor. I said, take the song, take the tape back, learn it. Just really learn it. Learn the words. Learn it without reading it. Learn it. So he said, okay. So he came back, and he knew the song. Sung the hell out of it.
We had about 10 flops, and in 1963 was when Berry Gordy put us, the Supremes, with Holland, Dozier, Holland.
So they didn't like the song. They didn't like it. And we said, well, fine. You know, I mean, I don't know exactly how the dialogue went, but they did not like the song. The song was supposed to be for them. At least I remember coming up with the thing for them, you know. Baby, where that on this? What? Honey. And so we decided to do it on the Supreme.
The Holland, Dozier, Holland team brought us Where Did Our Love Go? We didn't like it. And we said, listen, we're very serious. We want a hit. We have to have a hit, and this is not going to do it. You know, we want one like Martha and the Vandellas or like the Marvelettes.
But then the Supremes got wind of it and found out that it was a reject of the Marvelettes. So that created a whole lot of dissension for us. I mean, they were pissed. I mean, you know, and going in to do this, I mean, they couldn't refuse it because they weren't like the stars that we know today.
We want something rocking and rolling, you know. And they said, trust us, this is going to get hit.
We cut Where Did Our Love Go for the Supremes. The only thing with the Supremes, we didn't know whether we was going to let Mary Wilson sing it or Diana Ross sing it.
And so she was singing the song. And but with this surly attitude, you know, but it was just... It was just what the song needed.
I argued with Edward. Edward wanted Mary Wilson to sing it. Lamont and I wanted Diana Ross to sing it. Edward didn't want Diana Ross to sing because she had a nasal kind of sound in her voice.
And then the key that it was in was originally for the Gladys Horton key. So she was singing much lower. It was a surly attitude. Bam, instant smash. You know what I mean? You're like, baby. Well, I mean, you know what I mean? Just what the song needed. I mean, you couldn't ask for it. You couldn't rehearse it like that.
Each one of them had a specific area that they worked in, and then they worked together as a unit as well. But Lamont Dozier would work on our backgrounds.
I'm at the piano, bam, 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 baby, where an idea spring up.
Eddie Holland would work with Diane on the leads.
Brian and I get together, map out the arrangement of the song. Cut the track.
And I think Brian Holland would take care of the band, the production, the music production, and all those areas.
I get with Eddie then after that, show him what I had started lyrically on it and what the melody is. You take it from there and finish off.
Lamont Dozier, Brian Holland, and Eddie Holland pulled me from a Christmas party and had me record Heat Wave in Dead of Winter.
To smoking, even, you know, coming to me in the hallway again, the same hallway where I met Brian. He's heard me playing dum de lum de la. He said, man, what you gonna do with that? Da 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 da, you know, so forth.
Really, I mean, couldn't sleep. I mean, really thinking about what to do next and what song to come up with, how to come up with it.
Getting there, you don't know what kind of, you don't have that pressure. You're just doing. Me just doing, hoping something hit. But after it hits, then there's the pressure of trying to stay there and trying to keep on producing and writing.
Holland Dozier Holland called me whenever I came in off the road and there was a session scheduled. I was excited because I knew it was going to be a good song. And Nowhere to Run just typifies their talent and their style.
The workload was tremendous, and everybody wanted a HDA song, you know, and we couldn't possibly write for everybody, you know, and then people would get the attitudes, you know, okay, man.
He loved what we were doing, you know what I mean? And my relationship changed because I was a little closer to Barry than Edward or Lamont.
It's like they were reassigned. They were writing for us, and all of a sudden they were giving baby loves, and Where Did Our Love Go to Diane and her friends.
Yeah, I understand her point of view. I guess it seemed that way, you know.
We would write songs for the Supremes. A song in the process, if a song did not fit the Supremes, then we would sort of put it aside and we would do it on someone else.
The other groups had already had hit records. I mean, they were already very, very big. But something, and I've always said this, probably was beyond the music. Something about the Supremes was more than the music, because certainly Martha and the Vandellas were more soulful than we were. But I think it was a combination of the music, but the three personalities as well. I think a lot of it had to do with Diane's voice, which was extremely different than other voices out there. And then the songs were just great.
Got on burner.
It's constituted authority.
So you might say, oh, our workload, you know, we sort of like backed off it.
Slowdown was really caused by Edward in a sense that if we wrote a track, and we did do a few tracks, he didn't finish them, he didn't write them, nothing would have been done anyway.
I did. I did slow things down, but not for the reasons that he thought. I deliberately slowed things down because they were not producing or writing songs as strong as they were the year before.
My brother wanted, he's the one who really basically wanted to leave, you know, first.
Berry Gordy had promised my brother stock in Motown.
And he talked to me and talked to Lamont.
I knew that he was not going to do it.
Ask us what we want to do.
And I was trying to let my brother down easy. I was trying to tell him things that would make it easy for him because he had a lot of faith in Barry. He really looked up to Barry.
Because when disenchantment starts seeping in, everybody sort of feels that way, you know.
So then I went to Barry, I said, look, why don't you do this? I tried to come up with something. I said, look, why don't you do this? Why don't you allow us to have a label? And we'll have three artists, no more. I felt that that would pacify Brian and that would pacify Lamont.
I came to that point that, hey, I think I see the handwriting on the wall.
We had a wonderful run with Holland Dozier Holland, and every song that we recorded with them from the beginning was, you know, was like a hit. And in '67, it was very difficult when we realized that Holland Dozier Holland might be leaving?
Smokey came to me one day and said, man, he said, let them go, but you stay. You know, he said, I know it's your brother, man, but, you know, you should stay, you know, but I didn't, you know.
We decided just to, hey, just stop the dialogue between us. It had gone and made some attempts to make some dialogue with Barry, and all his efforts for all intents and purposes had failed, and there was nothing else to do. There was no alternative but to make a step and out the door.
Brian Lamont was at Motown, contractually tied up. I was as a writer, but I was not as a producer, so nothing stopped me from forming a label.
In my opinion, Capitol Records was not as deeply involved in black music as they would have wanted to be.
In the music industry, you had basically two broad kinds of distribution. One was independent distribution, where you would have an independent distributor who was not owned by a major like CBS.
Basically, the music industry, it was somewhat of a racist nature to it. And there were just certain jobs and certain positions that were relegated to black folk in the music industry.
Whereas with Capitol, they were what we call wholly owned. They had their wholly owned distributors across the country, so that they had much more control. They had 100% control over how their distributors operated.
I feel that we were that good. In other words, I was caught up in looking back, reflecting back. I was caught up in that I could do it all over again. You know, I didn't feel that I couldn't do it, you know, that we couldn't do it.
Well, I received a phone call from a guy that my wife says his name was Jeffrey Bowen.
I ran into Brian Holland, in New York, and a friend called me up and said, oh, guess who's here? Brian Holland, you remember him? I said, of course I know Brian. We went to high school together, you know, we were in classes together.
I got a call from a young man named Jeffrey Bowen, and he said he represented Holland Dozier, and they were interested in signing me.
They had detached themselves from Motown.
Okay.
Under a cloud. It was under a cloud because it was like a lot of cat and mouse going and detective stuff going on, you know, because I remember they used to say, we're being watched, you know, we saw that car down the street.
This was when Frida, my sister, was getting ready to sign with Invictus. And she had come in from New York, and she was on the telephone with Eddie Holland. And so I deliberately went into the living room, and I got on the piano, and I start playing very loudly and singing very loudly some songs I had written. So Eddie called me to the phone, and he asked me, what was I playing and singing? I said, oh, just some songs that I wrote, just a tune, you know.
That day, when I was met with Holland, Dozier Holland, at Lamont's house, after I finished singing these other things, Lamont played a little bit of that, and he said, one of me, can you say, yeah, just a little more?
Everybody just fell in love with the tune. See, the track was already cut, and so we wrote the songs and melody to the track, and that was the way that things used to basically be done, were being done, back then.
Going to the studio, learning the art of writing the songs, and at that point I said, I don't think I want to be no artist. I think I want to write and produce. So when the record came out, it was strange because I was rooting against it. But then again, it's that's me. You know, I don't want to be the part of no, I don't want to be the part of no failure. You know what I mean? It was like a strange feeling. It was funny because I like our first record. You got to understand, we were four guys who didn't know each other. In some cases, didn't even like each other. You know what I mean?
Every single day, I would go get Frieda. I would get Frieda and bring her down to the office. Cause the idea was with Frieda was to try to find somebody like the Supremes.
Oh, he's the one that literally taught me "Band of Gold." You know the lyrics, because when I first saw the lyric, I said to him, "What is this? This is like immature stuff. I would never do this. You know, this is for a 17-year-old." He says, "You don't have to like it. Just sing it, just like that."
Well, we were cutting the tune on her. I mean, a lot of times she just said, "Hey, I can't sing this. This just don't make no sense to me." She was just not in it, so I had to dub that thing. I think I dubbed the tune on her about maybe 25 or 30 times, just to get enough parts of it that we could edit to get the song.
I started hearing it on the radio.
Now, "Band of Gold," before that became a hit, we were getting ready to pull that record.
And then I was, of course, watching Billboard.
I thought, man, it's a smash record. Then all of a sudden, in Charlotte, North Carolina, the song went to number one.
Hey, I think I got a hit record, you know?
And from there is when it caught fire. We were on the verge of pulling it and coming up with something else. That song was a smash in the gay community. And I said, "Gay community?" I said, "Yeah, man, it's a smash." And I said, "So, why is it that?" You know, and he said, what the lyrics are saying. She's saying that the guy said he couldn't make love to her, so they figured he had to be gay. And I said, "Oh, no." So I said, and I remember when they said that to me, I said, And I listened back at the song, and I knew it was a part in there, because I remember when we were editing that tune, it was too long, so we had to cut a section out of the tune. And so the section that we cut out of the song really brought the whole song together.
People start calling. People call for like all kinds of things, personal appearances, benefits. They want you to be on this show, that show, TV, you know, requests for TV appearances.
All of a sudden now, more of the artists want you to write songs for them, because everybody wants to go to somebody who's successful. So now the rest of the people in the company are saying, "Well, wait a minute, write me a Give Me a Little More Time. Write me a Band of Gold. You write me a Patches," you know.
When I got to do American Bandstand, I knew I had arrived.
And our first job, I never will forget, was at the Apollo Theater. And man, we bumped into each other so bad doing this. We had one guy who was really hard-headed. He was always right, and he started off going the wrong way, and we bumped and bounced off each other for the 15 minutes that we were on stage. They had a meeting. No more routines.
Well, General was singing the song in a local club, like 20 Grand, for instance, and he would get a standing ovation every time he sung the song. Because
I mean, I sit at that piano and sit at that piano and sit at that piano, and I came with the greatest chord progression that I ever did, and that was a song called "I'm Depending on Your Love."
And so, but it wasn't the kind of tune, as I mentioned, that Holland and them really went for story type tunes, and they say, "It's okay, but we ain't interested in releasing nothing like that." Now, the chairman of the board, who had this smash, "Give Me a Little More Time," you know, looking for something more in that vein. Everything's Tuesday, and some other stuff was in the same vein as giving me a little more time. So it just sat there.
Because when Ava was saying, no, Brian, but listen to this, listen to this, listen to this, Ava. And then they went in and recorded the track.
And so Atlantic had heard about this tune that General Johnson was singing that it was getting standing ovations for. So they had called up and said, well, look, we want to record this tune on Clarence Carter. So they went in one weekend, they cut the track, they brought Clarence into New York on a Monday, Tuesday, dubbed it in, they mixed it that Wednesday, and it was on the air that following Monday. That's fast, because that's how strong they felt about it.
When she came out with Band of Gold, they left Detroit and went home. And they were so ticked that they were like, that song was for us, she sounds just like us. And I'm going like, you know, you guys are really, really sick and we're leaving. So they left.
Nobody was getting a hit on Honeycomb. So they gave us that responsibility to get a hit record.
Edward had called me in the office and he talked to me and he said, Edna, when you're in L.A., we can't do songs on you in L.A. because there's so many people here now that we're working on when they're in front of our face. And when you're out of town, it's like you're not here. So we don't, you know, the other producers don't say, oh, let's do it on the Honeycomb, let's do it on Freedom. They'll do it on whoever is here, whoever is the hungriest for it. He said, so you have to stay in town.
I wrote a song called Stick Up. Took it in. It's a, yeah, don't like it. Right? It was just a piano. This is when I was in Norfolk. You right? Nah. Don't like it.
We started on Stick Up the same night as One Is. It was like the follow-up song, but it was like, they were very close.
Greg came to me and said, Bonnie Perkins, who was the engineer at for Invictus Records.
He said, you know, Greg, somebody should write a song about the One Is. I said, the One Ads? Yeah, you know, the One Ads. Everybody needs a job and blah, blah. Everybody's looking at the One Ads. And I wasn't driving at the time. And that car broke down. I got on the bus and immediately I said, yeah, One Ads. Going to put it in the One Ads. I need some love for sale.
Took my same chord progression that we have for Stick Up, use it for One Ads.
Well, I recorded One Ads and you know, it was okay song, we, you know, and it got put in the can, and I didn't think any more of it.
We knew we had, you know, we knew what we had, and we knew the feeling that it, you know, that it needed.
So I went to the studio, and I bumped into Greg, and I forgot he was going to be the studio. I said, oh, well, good, we can go to the movies from here. But while I was there, Sherry was in there, and she was singing this little song, He No Longer Rings My Chimes, He Don't Turn Me On. I got to put it in the One Ads. And I said, damn, that's bad. And Edward looked at me and he said, you think that's bad? I said, that is so catchy. Going to put it in the, He No Longer Rings My Chimes. I said, my goodness, that's, an, you know, and I was like way up here about the song.
About a year later, I walk into the studio and I'm hearing One Ads. And I said, oh, wow, I haven't heard this song in a long time. I sat down and listened to it, and just as it got near the end, I said, wait a minute, I don't remember doing that line like that. And then Barney Perkins, who was the engineer, said, well, no, that's not you, that's Edna. I said, Edna, right? Recorded One Ads? The Honeycomb did One Ads? He said, yeah.
And when Sherry comes out of the studio, I said, Sherry, that is bad, and you sound so good. You sound great on it. So she said, you think it's so great? She said, you can sing it. I don't like it. So I said, I'll take it.
Lipstick on his collar, perfume on it too, tells me he's been lying.
was riding down La Brea on my way to work. And it came on, and I'm like, ah! I started screaming. I pulled over to the side and like cut a jig. I was ecstatic. And my voice was like right out here. It was like, whoa, it was way up here. And I was like, oh my God, I'm way out here. This is me. This is what I was talking about. This is why I made the jump from LA to Detroit. This is what I signed that dumb contract about, to have my name and my voice on a record. That's signaturing what I do.
So sweet and cautiously, he cased my love.
When the Honeycomb record broke, we broke harder and faster than everybody, because it was a phenomenon as far as three girls coming back out, three nice looking girls, and the Supremes were coming like this because Diana Ross had left them, and the Honeycombs were going like this, and then our second record hit and it was gold. And then our third record hit and it was gold.
Well, number one, it makes us think that we're doing things right from a creative and from a marketing point of view as far as it goes. It also means that a lot of people are getting in touch with you for whatever reason. You know, you're being contacted by nightclubs, and the artists are asked to go on personal appearance.
The westbound number 9, gonna leave this town, leave it far behind. Gonna leave all I've got, my peace of mind, on the westbound number 9. Get my ticket for the westbound number 9. Gonna leave this town, leave it far behind. Gonna leave all I've got, my peace of mind, on the westbound number 9.
Well, it calls the people to take notice. And that generate revenue, obviously, and then it helps bring in more artists, you know what I mean?
So you have all the trappings, and you have all of these avenues in the record industry that are contacting you because you are what's happening, and everybody believes that you want to fully, you know, you're going to just take off.
This is what you've lived for, this you dreamed of, and you're living out a dream. So, the company can't do nothing wrong to you at that time.
Now, the song originally, Let Me Tell the Truth, was supposed to have been for Laura Lee. And they gave it to me because they knew that they were working on my, at that point, they wanted to keep the ball, they wanted to build me at that point. And at that point, like the same thing they did at Motown, you know, it's common. Was a national hit, and even in spite of a controversy, and that controversy being that the song, we received a telegram from the United States government stating that this song had been banned from being played in South Vietnam because it was giving aid and comfort to the enemy.
I think we were, administratively, we had gotten early into a point where we were elated at how the artists were being exposed.
Great. We were so big in New York, it was ridiculous. Oh, yeah.
And we were trying to meet that demand for our artists to make appearances.
They called me to do the dating game.
And then, to be able to go to Los Angeles.
And it was an interview from Time's newspaper in Los Angeles.
And look out in the audience, and Elgin Baylor sitting out there. Oh, man, Elgin Baylor sitting out in the audience. You know what I mean? You know, Diana Ross and all, they was out there, but Elgin Baylor was my man. You know what I mean?
So we have this outward glee, but internally, we have product commitments that must be fulfilled in terms of the various arrangements we had with Capitol Records and Buddha Records and all the foreign distributors.
And, you know, and it was really funny because they were talking about Edna Wright, Sister of Darlene Love, and it was all the news. It was really fun.
But keep in mind, at the same time, we're also looking at the books and records. And we can see that we're still not selling albums.
The record business is a lot more to it than just writing hit songs. I learned that quickly.
It came a point, and let's say on or around 1971, when it became clear to us that the relationship with Capitol Records was not what we wanted it to be. We were not generating the kind of album sales that we knew we should be able to generate.
CBS Records was also considering making a major thrust into black music. And my name was one of the names that was suggested to them. I don't know from whom.
And then we, out of the blue, we get a call from Clive Davis at CBS Records.
My mission was to come in and to create a black marketing division and saturate the black market with Columbia's product.
Well, when he first called, we didn't know the extent of his interest. But he flew into Detroit.
Stax was sort of just floating around having financial difficulty. And Al Bell got through to Clive Davis. And they sat down and worked out the deal.
And what he said to us was that he wanted us to consider a relationship with CBS, that he would in effect triple or quadruple our sales.
Now also around that same time we had T-Neck, the Isaac Brothers, he brought that label over there. So there was a T-Neck label, there was Stax Records, there also was D-Vale Records out of Buffalo, New York.
Now, unbeknownst to us, at the same time that he was wooing us, he was also wooing the two other, aside from Motown, the two other top independent black record labels in the industry at that time.
Well, the CBS deal came into play after things were deteriorating with Capitol Records. Now, Clive Davis was at the helm of the CBS deal, so Clive was in favor of the Invictus move. Now, at that same time, CBS had done a study, and it was a really interesting study because it was a study done by Harvard.
Well, the way that Harvard report came to me, Bruce Lundvall called me into his office, and he told me about this project that had been proposed with Harvard.
We sealed that deal. We then thought that we were going to enter a whole new era of substantial sales, and we actually entered an era of deceit and problems.
Well, we found, yes, black music, there's plenty of money to be made in it.
We then discovered that CBS had commissioned Harvard in 1970 to do a study on the impact of black music.
Yes, traditionally, the white, large distribution record companies had stayed away from black music.
But the preamble was that black music was going to be the dominant music going into year 2000.
Yes, there's money to be made in it, and it's worth doing.
Phase one, in essence, was to understand black radio and all of its nuances.
Well, it sort of gave us a blueprint for the marketplace. And the idea is that we want to capture the black music business for CBS Records. And this is a way to do it.
In phase two, that it did not have, CBS should recognize that it does not have the internal capabilities to develop and produce black music. And so as a consequence, it advised CBS to associate with successful black-owned independent labels.
No reason in the world to stay away from one market segment. If you're in country, if you're in jazz, if you're in classical, if you're in pop, why not be in soul music?
Then phase three said, recognize that these independent black-owned labels could walk away from you. So that your end objective is to ensure that these black recording artists and producers, writers are signed directly to CBS.
I don't know of any obvious move that was made in that direction.
We would get a call from Bibb Distributors in Charlotte, North Carolina. Bibb was a major distributor product all throughout the South. And the call would be, look, Invictus, Mr. Tucker, you know, you're getting all kinds of airplay down here on such and such a record, but it's not in the stores.
I do know from conversations that a lot of artists, whether they are on Invictus, Philadelphia International, DVL, or whatever distributed label, there's always that thought there that I would rather be on the mother label.
I had been involved in planning, now I was more involved in planning, but I was involved in implementing the marketing and the promotion of the product.
And we get responses like, oh, we had a major pressing from the Beatles, or we had a backup from so-and-so, from Barry Manilow. And we're sorry, but we'll get caught up. Now, this is the same CBS that was going to quadruple our sales by their superior distribution mechanisms.
Clive ran into problems with CBS, with this position as the CEO of CBS, so he left.
So now I get a call that says, look, you're getting sales just off of in-store play, and we don't hear your product on the airwaves. It's not on the major radio stations. What's going on?
Columbia signed Stax Records and then took all their artists.
Once we realized how big this record industry is and how much black music contributes to it.
I mean, they absorbed their acts and no longer Stax Records.
Then obviously, it's something that black people should be concerned about from an ownership point of view.
They signed Invictus, and as soon as we got with Columbia, it all fell apart.
Yeah, everybody thought, it was sort of like, I said, everybody, I should be the happiest girl in the world. I said, but I'm miserable. I was miserable.
And then you look up and all of a sudden, there's some operative who's approaching someone like a Freda Payne at the Blue Room in D.C., and in a sense saying, you know, Freda, you should be much further along than you are.
Well, first one was Lamont. So Lamont is the first one that broke ground and went there, you know. So when Lamont went, then there was just like a flow of people, you know, who were, so wait a minute, Lamont's gone?
It was Brian, you know, and I were very close. I mean, there was a very spiritual thing, I guess, between the three of us, you know. And you had to take all of that in consideration, you know what I mean? And it was not an easy thing for me. And many nights I cried and hurt behind the move that I made, you know.
It took the three of them, Holland, Dozier, Holland.
Because it was painful. It was painful to me. I mean, I'm sure it was painful to them. They didn't want to lose the company. They didn't want to see. Here they had the possibility of having, you know, they had a great company, and it could have been even greater. And it just went down the tubes.
We got a call from a really masterful dean lawyer out of Stax who indicated for me to place a call to New York and talk to a Logan Westbrook, that he had found out some information that in effect there was a conspiracy to run the major black independent labels out of business.
Now, I certainly don't feel that I have anything to apologize for.
So we all met the same demise around the same time. Ultimately, we had a meeting in Detroit with all of us, with Kenny, Leon, Al Bell, all of us, and realized what had occurred.
Got fed up with things being the way they were, and I just went home. I just went home.
And that is basically what kind of like got me ticked off. That got me pissed off because I felt that I was being screwed.
Company couldn't put out records, continue to put out records, or they weren't putting out records. And so I came to California.
You know, when you talk about experience in the business, you can't do too much better than Eddie Holland and Lamont Dozier.
They have a group called Platoon, and we're in the process of getting ready to release. We've had some things out locally.
These guys, were putting out hits and, you know, great music for many, many years.
Got Ronnie Laws, got a great group, I think it's a Toe Smash, a group called Forche. another group for you, Q&A, you know, and Rick. So we start putting all this thing together.
There's a lot more to be said and a lot more coming from us.
If what we're doing with the new artists that we have is very successful, absolutely.